special welcome to our guests this morning. Great to have you with us as we continue to hear God's wonderful work in the life of Elisha, God's wonderful work in our lives as he looks to take care of us. Before I forget, I'll ask, please make sure to sign in, fill in the guest register that should be along the end of the pew on this side. If you haven't already done so and somebody's in the way, nudge them and get that pad and sign in for us, please. Thank you. As I said, we continue our look at God and work in our lives just as he was at work in the life of Elisha. Elisha lived in a world of evil. We live in a world of evil. One of the greatest dangers of the evil that surrounds us is not necessarily the evil that's going to attack us like that, but the evil that's going to work from the inside and suck us into its evil. And so we ask and we pray that our God would deliver us not just from the evil that would pound us, but from the evil that would infect us from inside. God of grace and God of glory.
Thank you.
our Lord Jesus, we have a Redeemer and a Savior. Jesus paid the penalty for our guilt by his death on the cross and freed us from death by his resurrection from the grave. We have peace with God now and forever. Amen.
Chapter 6.
Syria. Now the king of Aram was at war with Israel. After conferring with his officers, he said, I will set up my camp in such and such a place. The man of God, that's Elisha, sent word to the king of Israel, beware of passing that place, because the Arameans are going down there. So the king of Israel checked on the place indicated by the man of God. Time and again, Elisha warned the king so that he was on his guard in such places. This enraged the king of Aram. He summoned his soldiers and officers and demanded of them, tell me, which of us is on the side of the king of Israel? None of us, my lord the king, said one of his officers. But Elisha, the prophet who is in Israel, tells the king of Israel the very words you speak in your bedroom. Go, find out where he is, the king ordered, so I can send men and capture him. The report came back. He is in Dothan. Then he sent horses and chariots and a strong force there. They went by night and surrounded the city. When the servant of the man of God got up and went out early the next morning, an army with horses and chariots had surrounded the city. Oh no, my lord, what shall we do? The servant asked. Don't be afraid, the prophet answered. Those who are with us are more than those who are with them. And Elisha prayed, open his eyes, Lord, so that he may see. Then the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he looked, and saw the hills full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We join together and sing a version of Psalm 91.
Thank you.
Our second lesson is found in the book of Revelation, chapter 12. In the first part of Revelation, we see various judgments on the world. In the second half of Revelation, which begins with chapter 12, we see the activity of Satan and Satan's partners in evil. But we especially see the power and the victory of Jesus Christ, that Jesus works through himself and also through his team, including the angels. We're told that war broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought back. But he was not strong enough, and they lost their place in heaven. The great dragon was hurled down. That ancient serpent called the devil or Satan, who leads the whole world astray, he was hurled to the earth, and his angels with him. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, "Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Messiah. For the accuser of our brothers and sisters, who accuses them before our God day and night, has been hurled down. They triumphed over him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. They did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. Therefore rejoice, you heavens, and you who dwell in them. But woe to the earth and the sea, because the devil has gone down to you. He is filled with fury, because he knows that his time is short." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We stand for the gospel of our Lord. Hallelujah! Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take courage, it is I. Don't be afraid." Hallelujah. Our gospel lesson recorded for us in the Gospel of Matthew in chapter 18. You will notice in the last verse, the last line of our lesson, why this lesson is chosen for today, as you have Jesus' promise of angels watching. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Who then is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" He called a little child to him and placed the child among them. And he said, "Truly I tell you, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever takes the lowly position of this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. If anyone causes one of these little ones, those who believe in me, to stumble, it would be better for them to have a large millstone hung around their neck and to be drowned in the depths of the sea. Woe to the world because of the things that cause people to stumble. Such things must come, but woe to that person through whom they come. If your hand or your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to enter like maimed or crippled than to have two hands or two feet and be thrown into eternal fire. And if your eye causes you to stumble, gouge it out and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life with one eye than to have two eyes and be thrown into the fire of hell. See that you do not despise one of these little ones. For I tell you that there are angels in heaven always see the face of my Father in heaven." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. We join together. Lord God, to you we give all praise.
Thank you.
removal. And at the top of the hill, there was just enough room for me and that oil tanker semi that was speeding right in my direction. I'd like to claim credit that I made a good guess and moved over, but I know that it wasn't just a guess on my part because I'm not nearly that good of a guesser. And I know I'm not that good a driver. It seemed like probably just a couple miles further down the road. Full speed, I drove into the sandhill ditch. And then full speed, I drove out of that sandhill ditch without flipping over, without getting stuck in the sand ditch. And I know that wasn't me. And I know that wasn't my Mercury Zephyr, because my Mercury Zephyr was no Land Cruiser, that's to be sure. And I'm no Mario Andretti. I'm convinced that the only reason I got home safely that day was because of God and his angels looking out for me. Now I'd imagine that you have your angel stories, and I wouldn't doubt at all that your angel stories beat mine hands down. But thinking about our angel stories got me thinking about, do the angels ever talk about their angel stories? Do they ever talk about their angel stories, those things that, wow, look what I got to do, look what I got to say, look what I got to be part of with Jesus? Like perhaps the angel Gabriel, nudging some of those other angels, telling about that good, that special day when that angel Gabriel appeared to the young Virgin Mary. Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you. And then got to share that incredible, impossible promise. You will be the mother of God's forever and ever King. And how we got to top that promise off with or nothing is impossible with God. Then a few months later, that angel up in the sky at night, up in the night sky over Bethlehem Hill Country, appearing to the shepherds, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the city of David, a Savior is born. He is Christ the Lord. And then the sky filled with the glory of God and who knows how many more angels. Glory to God in the highest. And on earth, peace. Or how about 30 years later, after Jesus was baptized for battle, and the Holy Spirit led Jesus out into the wilderness where he faced off against Satan and put Satan in his place. For 40 days and 40 nights, nothing to eat or drink. His body worn out, attacking Satan, facing Satan, day after day, hour, minute after minute, worn down. And an angel comes to tend Jesus and get him ready for what's next. Or about 3 years later, the Garden of Gethsemane. Shortly before Jesus is arrested, the day before Jesus is hung out to die, killed on the cross. As the weight of the world's guilt is coming down on the Holy One, Jesus, as the thought of his Father cursing him is crushing the Son of God, Jesus. As Peter, James, and John couldn't keep themselves awake to be there for Jesus, an angel comes to tend to Jesus and help him to get ready for that next day, to help him get ready for the cross. Time after time after time, the angels were there for Jesus when Jesus needed their encouragement, their support. And so I wonder how hard it was for those angels to step back. and hold themselves back as the Father crushed and cursed his Son and made Jesus to pay for your sin and mine. I wonder how hard it was for those angels to step back and watch. But then what do we hear next? Easter Sunday morning. Who's on the scene? Angels again? Angels with that good news. He's not here. He's risen. And now today, what about today? Can you imagine what the angels' favorite thing to talk about, to sing about, could be today? How about this? God's plan, God's power, God's promise to save from Satan. God's plan, God's power, God's promise in Jesus to save sinners. That's right, the angels love to talk about and sing about how God in Jesus forgives those who have sinned against God. How God forgives you and me with Jesus. And today, what do the angels love to talk about? What do they love to sing about? God's plan, God's power, God's promise that we get to join the angels in heaven. Isn't that amazing? What has the angels fired up? That we get to join them. I think that has probably worked its way into being one of my favorite Bible scenes with the angels. How the angels are cheering and celebrating that people like me, that us, that we get to be together with them in heaven. Now you may have a different favorite angel lesson story. One of my old favorites is in our lesson today, back at the time of the life of Elisha. Now we don't know when this happened, whether it was before or after Elisha healed Naaman. If it were after Elisha healed Naaman, what would we expect? We'd expect that the king of Syria, Aram, would be getting along better with the king of Israel, that they'd be getting along in some sort of peace after Elisha did that good thing for the king of Aram. Or if it were before Elisha healed Naaman, what would we expect? We'd expect that when it was time for Naaman, he needed a cure, we would expect that there would have been better peace between the king of Aram and the king of Israel, but there sure wasn't. And so what do we see either way, whether this lesson comes before or after Elisha heals Naaman? Elisha and Naaman are not, I'm sorry, the king of Syria and the king of Israel are not getting along. They're not living happily ever after. The king of Aram, the king of Syria, is waging war against the king of Israel. And as it happens, as he's making his war plans with his war council, he says, we're going to camp here. This will be a good place to set up so that we can attack. And then what happened? Elisha would take that secret plan, that secret battle plan, that secret news, and he would share it with the king of Israel, who would send out his scouts and find out, Elisha, the man of God, he's right. There is the enemy army. And then that weak army of Israel would be able to steer clear and keep themselves safe. Now, this didn't just happen once or twice. It happened again and again so that the king of Syria, he was feeling a bit paranoid. He was feeling, he was getting upset. Who's the traitor? Who's the spy that's passing along our secret battle plans? And somebody was brave enough to say, there is no spy, there is no traitor here, it's Elisha. Now, by this time, Elisha was no secret in Israel. People knew, the king knew, where he was getting that news, the secret battle plans of Syria. And because it was no secret in Israel who Elisha was and what Elisha was doing, also then it was no secret to Syria's spies who Elisha was and what Elisha was doing and where Elisha was. And so the king of Aram sends out his army to solve his Elisha problem. He doesn't just send a SWAT team to take Elisha. He sends an army unit with horses and chariots, enough to surround that city where Elisha was staying. And overnight they do just that. While everybody in town is sleeping, they surround that city where Elisha was. Early the next morning, Elisha's servant gets up, goes out, and what does he see? An army with horses and chariots have surrounded the city. Can imagine, huh? What's going through his mind? What comes out of his mouth? How do you say yikes in Hebrew, huh? And then he asks Elisha, "Oh Lord, what will we do?" Elisha is calm and confident. No yikes coming out from Elisha. No, he's confident the Lord has got him, and so he knows that the Lord has got this too. And so Elisha answers his servant, "Don't be afraid. Those who are with us are more than those who are with them." That's just too good to hear but once. Don't be afraid. Those who are with us are more than those who are with them. Now, Elisha wasn't talking about the army of Israel. That army of Israel wasn't enough to put fear into the king of Syria, and it certainly wasn't enough to give anybody like Elisha calm or confidence. But Elisha was thinking about another army with a different commander. He was thinking of the army commanded by the Lord of hosts, God's angel army. And so Elisha prays, "O Lord, open his eyes so he may see." And so the Lord opened the servant's eyes so that he was able to see the hills full of horses and chariots of fire all around. Elisha knew. And now his servant saw that with the Lord and his angels, they didn't have anything to be afraid about. Abraham, years earlier, Abraham saw the Lord and two angels looking like regular guys, people. Jacob saw angels ascending and descending on a ladder, a staircase to heaven. The writer to the Hebrews talks about angels as ministering spirits. Here in our lesson, we see angels as horses and chariots of fire. We might wonder, different kinds of angels? Angels appearing in different ways? When you look in the book of Revelation, Jesus shows us many different pictures with angels, different kinds of angels, appearings in many different ways, some very, very different ways. But what was true of all of them? God created them. God commands them. They listen. And God uses them for you and for me, for his church. God sends his angels to serve us and protect us in ways that we might never know. God uses them to defend us, fight for us against Satan and Satan's armies in ways that we may never see. But even though we don't see it, even though we might not know, God is still and always doing his thing to save and to protect and to serve again and again through his angels. hesitate to say this, but what if? What if? What if God commands his angels to step back? What if God commands his angels to step back and let evil strike and knock me down? Perhaps like Jacob, cheated by his uncle Laban. Or like Joseph, sold into slavery and then thrown into prison. Or like Job, who lost most everything he had except God's hold on him. Or like Jesus, who gave up most everything he had except his hold on God. Or like Peter and James and the rest of the apostles. What then? What then? What if God commands the angels to step back? What if, what then? When God commands the angels to let the enemy strike, what then? Well, with Jacob, Joseph, and Job, what do we see in their lives? With Jacob, Joseph, and Job, we see an incredible amount of hurt and heartache. An incredible amount of hurt and heartache that was turned into an incredible amount of blessing. Jacob, for example, was cheated and bullied by his father-in-law, by his uncle Laban, for 20-some years. And then he was made to believe that his favorite son, Joseph, was killed. And then as he thought he was going to end his days in the promised land, he was forced by famine to leave behind that land that God had promised him and to go down to Egypt. Apart from a peek here and a peek there, seeing the angels wrestling with God, Jacob didn't know when the angels were stepping in, when they were stepping back. He couldn't see them. But what do we know? Because we know the rest of the story. That in all things, even when God commanded his angels to step back, God worked for Jacob's good. God worked to keep his promise to Jacob, and not just for Jacob, but for all of us. God worked his promise and plan. And in the life of Joseph, sold by his own brothers into slavery, then thrown into prison for doing good. Joseph, we're not told of him ever seeing the angel stepping in or stepping back or seeing God, but what do we know? That in the life of Joseph, God worked all things together for his good. Even when God or his angels step back, God still worked for the good of Joseph, and not just for Joseph, but for the good of all his people, for the good of us. And Job, oh, he lost his children, he lost his riches, he lost his wife's smile. All in one day. And then he lost his health in a most awful way. And yet, what do we know? In all things, even when God had his angels step back, God worked for the good of Job. We know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. And his purpose for you, he calls you his. For Jacob, for Joseph, for Job, as we look through the pages of Scripture, what do we see? We see their lives go from pain into comfort and great blessing. But what about for Peter and James and the rest of those apostles and so many others? What about when God's angels let the knife cut and the cross kill? One of the 12, tucked in the corner over there, John, he shows us a picture from Jesus. He reveals for us a revelation from Jesus. And what do we see? Angels, countless angels, angels around the throne of God with Jesus and his Father. We see and hear angels singing and praising God, singing and praising back and forth and back and forth, singing and praising the Savior. For the saints that he's saving. But not just singing about the Savior and those saints he's saving, but singing together with the saints. We see and hear the angels singing together with those saints in heaven. Now, when they were here in this world, those saints up in heaven, oh, they were like us. They couldn't see whether the angels were stepping in or stepping back and away from them. In this life, it may well have, for them, it may well have looked like the angels were stepping back a whole lot more than they were stepping in. But what do we get to see? We get to see them and the angels singing together in heaven. Because what do they know? They know that God, with his angels, that God gets his people home. God gets his people home. And so, but what if? How do we put those words to rest in here? When, but what if, what if, what if, what if is eating at our heart and soul and faith? How do we put those words to rest? Listen to Elisha. Don't be afraid. Those who are with us are more than those who are with them and against us. Listen to the writer of Psalm 91. We sang it. The Most High will command his angels to guard you in all your ways. Listen to the promise of Jesus, as Jesus promises angels to look out for you and to look out for yours. And if God has them step back, even then, God is working his plan and his promise for the good of you, his people. And even then, you get to know that God still has his angels on alert, ready, ready to step in for you, ready to step in for yours. And what do you get to know today and always? We get to know that we have our favorite angel story, our favorite angel sightings still ahead of us. How so? Someday we will be singing with the angels. Singing with the angels in heaven, thanking God. Thanking God for Jesus and thanking God for the way that he's kept us safe with his angels. Our favorite angel time is still ahead of us. We get to look forward to heaven with Jesus and his angels. Amen. The peace of God that passes our understanding. Keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. For those who are with us are more than those who are with them and against us. Amen. We stand and we join Christ's church in the words of the Nicene Creed. We join together. We believe in one God.
For us and for our sons.
Did you notice that line where we confessed our faith that God has angels for us? That would be the second line, the first sentence. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. Looking out for us. Eternal Lord, give us peace as we ponder the good news that you forgive our sins in Christ. Lead us to see clearly the path that you have laid out for us. Work in us so that we believe and live the word we have heard today. Provide courage and compassion to all who preach and teach your word. Fill them with a love like yours as they proclaim your grace to us and all people. Move us to love all ministers of the word wherever they serve. Guard and guide the families of our congregation. Lead husbands and wives to love each other with commitment, respect, and patience. Help parents to grasp the eternal value of keeping their children close to Jesus all their lives. Grant joy to those who are single and make them a blessing to others. Protect us. Provide wisdom and insight to those who make laws and set policies. Give us respect for those who protect us from crime. Lead us to value the rights of our fellow citizens and to defend those who cannot defend themselves. Bless our land with peace and prosperity so that the gospel may be proclaimed to all. Give us passion to share the story of your love with our family and friends. Overcome unbelief and open the hearts of people everywhere to believe the good news that Jesus has forgiven their sins and opened the gates to heaven. Fill us with joy over every sinner who repents and comes to trust in you. Extend your healing power to those who are sick and suffering in body or mind. Give patience and compassion to all who care for the sick and the dying. Lift the eyes of the distressed to your love in Christ. We pray for our sister Rose and her family. This past week, our Lord of Life took Rose's mom home to heaven. And so we ask that the Lord would bless Rose and her family with the comfort and peace that come with Jesus. We also pray for Paul Massey's family. This last week, Paul and I were meeting over ministry council elder business, and his mom let him know that his uncle was about to die, and the Lord took him home very quickly. And Paul asked that we would pray to comfort the family with that sure hope and peace that we have in Jesus. Oh, Lord God, Lord of life and death, we thank you for all the mercies with which you have blessed our fellow believers who are now fallen asleep. We thank you especially for having brought them to the knowledge of your Son, Jesus. We pray that you would comfort their families and all who mourn their deaths. Comfort them with your precious promises and cheer them with the sure hope of a blessed reunion in heaven. Teach us to number our days aright, that we may gain hearts of wisdom and finally be saved to sing together with the saints and angels in heaven. Through Jesus Christ, our risen and ever-living Lord. Amen. Lord Jesus, we also come to you today as we have our opening service for a new school year later today. We thank you, Lord, for the way that you have blessed us as we get ready for this new school year. We thank you for the ways that you have answered our prayers and have met our needs. We ask that you would continue to answer our prayers, continue to meet our needs, and set us up to be sharing that wonderful promise that we have with you, a promise of life for today and life taken care of today in the family of God, and a life together with the saints and angels in heaven forever. Bless our students, their families, our teachers, their families, all who serve to
Make our school ministry strong and a blessing. Bless us, Lord Jesus. Hear us, Lord, as we pray in silence. Gracious God, you govern and direct all things, and you love all people. Hear our prayers, spoken and silent, and answer them in your wisdom and grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We stand and we join together. Our Father, who art in heaven, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. In the Lord's Supper, Jesus promises great and wonderful blessings. And that same Jesus who promises great and wonderful blessings through the Apostle Paul, he gives us some heart-stopping, heart-concerning warnings about coming to the Lord's Supper in a way that isn't prepared and right. And so I say to our congregation members, if your self-examination and preparation for the Lord's Supper trouble you, then let's please talk so that you are able to come to the Lord's table in peace. And if you are not a member of our congregation yet, to our guests I say, if you're not a member, we invite you to join us. You know, I stand here and I read things wrong. If you're a member of a congregation in fellowship with us, I see the Johnsons. We invite you to come to the Lord's Supper with us. And if you're guests who are not in fellowship with us, who are not yet members of our congregation, I say, let's talk before you come to the table. We join.
The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts, we lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who promised that wherever two or three come together in his name, there he is with them to shepherd his flock until he comes again in glory. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song.
Thank you.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, drink you all of it. This cup is a new testament in my blood, poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
We stand. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His mercy endures forever.
Whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. We give you thanks, O Lord, for the foretaste of the heavenly banquet that you have given us in this sacrament. Through this gift you have fed our faith, nourished our hope, and strengthened our love. By your Spirit, help us to live as your holy people until that day when you will receive us as your guests at the wedding supper of the Lamb, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look on you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. You may be seated. It might seem a bit strange to sing that we have stars shining in the dark sky over us when we still have the heat of the day ahead of us. But that last couple lines of the last verse, sweet slumbers may he send you and bid his hosts attend you. It's always good to pray that God will have his angels watching out for us so that we can have peace in the day and peace at night. It's good to be able to worship with you this morning. It is good to know together with you that we have God and his armies that are looking out for us in this world. We have a special day ahead of us. We have Bible study. For Bible study this morning, we'll be looking at those special agents that God has at work. We'll be looking at angels and what the Bible tells us about angels. And then after that is an opportunity for our school families to move their stuff in for the new school here. At noon, we have a short opening service. And then after that, we have picnic. And we have a short, simple picnic that will be outside. If it'll be too hot, you can take your food downstairs. That'll be fine and good. It's a special time, and you get to meet and greet and mingle with some of the school families and help them to be part of our St. John family. Meditations are now available, a daily devotion on the back there and also over here. $3 or $4. And if you see something on that project list, that work list that you can help out with, let me know. Thank you. Good to worship with you. We'll see you downstairs.